Today's video is a recap of Gangster No. 1, a British crime drama film directed by Paul McGuigan. The film features Paul Bettany, Malcolm McDowell, David Thewlis, and Saffron Burrows. If you enjoy the video, please like it, subscribe to the channel, or leave a comment below. The film kicks off with the opening credits over a slow-motion, romanticized boxing match, accompanied by Neil Hannon singing the melancholy theme of The Good Life, a song that perfectly captures the gangster's pursuit of power and the empty escape it brings from pain and loneliness. We see an unnamed British veteran gangster smoking a cigar with a group of friends, living this good life, before he drunkenly heads to the bathroom with a head likely full of expensive crystal. He places his drink on the floor beside the urinal, and we see drops of urine splatter into it, observed silently by the doorman. The gangster finishes, picks up the glass, pretends to almost take a sip, and breaks the fourth wall to ask the audience, "What do you take me for?" A cut, before tossing it. This serves as our introduction to the aging gangster. He learns from his gangster friends that after 30 years, a man named Freddie Mays has been released from prison, immediately triggering emotions in the gangster and prompting a flashback. Quickly bringing us to the start of the story in the 60s, we see a young man playing pool at a club. Malcolm McDowell, who plays the gangster in the first scene, narrates how his role as an enforcer for a man ironically named Fat Charlie earned him an invitation to meet Freddie Mays, the top gangster in Britain. Young gangster sits across from Freddie in his lush high-rise penthouse, overwhelmed by the power that the man represents. Gangster becomes immediately addicted to the sensation, sipping at a glass of whiskey that can't hope to match this high. The gangster is eager to please, his violence impresses Mays, and he proves his loyalty with creative methods of murder. However, the gangster is obsessed with and jealous of May's success and glamorous lifestyle from the start, as demonstrated by his luxury clothing and plush flat. The gangster gradually attempts to model himself after Freddie more and more often, and at one point, Freddie, as a sign of trust, gives him his tie pin with his initials, which the gangster proudly exhibits on his tie. Discovering that May's rival, Lenny Taylor, plans to kill Mays, the gangster decides to let the attack take place instead of warning him. He kills the only other member of his gang who is aware of the plan. The gangster watches as Taylor and his gang shoot and stab Mays, and slit the throat of his fiancée, Karen. After getting Freddie out of the way, the gangster turns his attention to Lenny Taylor to eliminate the competition and to satisfy some murderous desires and release pent-up rage. Calmly driving to Lenny's apartment, gangster anticipates the ultimate act through the mantra of green light as the traffic lights clear the path for the unstoppable force. He arrives at the apartment parking garage, with Bettany tightening his face into a skull scream a few times throughout the film, illustrating the primal psycho that's always just beneath the cool exterior. It could easily come across as laughable instead of chilling, but Paul Bettany makes it effective enough, combined with the eerie chalk-like screech we hear each time. He attaches the silencer to his pistol as the elevator ascends and heads down the corridor once he reaches Lenny's floor. The tension builds as we approach the crescendo of violence, with McDowell's narration about the visible doors and corridors growing more intense and condensed. Eventually, gangster knocks down the door, shooting Lenny in the legs so he can't escape, and the most remembered scene of the film begins as gangster gets to work on Lenny with his bag of murder tools, including a chisel among other instruments. The camera takes on a fisheye perspective, the lights in the room becoming cold and brighter, the reds and blues standing out, and gangster takes his time to carefully disrobe down to his wife beater and underwear before slowly finishing Lenny off with his dreaded axe and tool-assisted fists. We get some confusing close-ups that effectively convey the chaos, as Lenny strains and gangster grins, viciously stabbing him with his tools. We also get some first-person shots from Lenny's perspective, making us directly involved in Lenny's demise. Once he's finished, the camera slowly zooms in on gangster as he reclines in a chair, covered in blood and smoking a cigarette while mumbling every British insult and threat in his vocabulary to the dead man. The gangster finds out the following day that May survived, but was hospitalized. Mays is unjustly convicted of ordering Taylor's murder and sent to prison for 30 years. With Mays out of the way, the gangster assumes leadership of the gang and consolidates his position. In a sequence spanning the years between 1968 and 1999, he is shown organizing a bank heist, opening a casino, fixing horse races, and building his gang to over 300. The narrative returns to the aged gangster at the boxing event, where he discovers that Taron also survived and is due to marry Mays, who has left prison a changed man. The gangster summons Mays to his old flat, which the gangster took over. The gangster, seeking to resolve any threat and his own demons, offers Mays money and the flat. However, Mays seems to have no fight left in him, wanting only to marry Taron and retire in peace. The gangster threatens Mays with a gun, then gives Mays the gun, confesses his silence over the attempted murder and Taylor's death, and begs Mays to kill them. Mays leaves, acknowledging how empty and pathetic the gangster's life is. The film ends with gangster drunk on a rooftop in his underwear. The good life plays again, as he tosses his money around, alone in the world, and steps from the roof. His last words are, "I am the number one." The idea.